حققتم
الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين أما بعد. So brothers and sisters, in the first part of khutbah we have learned that our objective and our goal is to establish the tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have also covered the first two principles in order to implement the tawheed and to fulfill the rights of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. First, to believe that Allah is unique in His actions. Secondly, that our actions should be devoted, should be only for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the third principle is that it is every single Muslim to believe in the beautiful names and the most perfect attributes of Allah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Ar-Rahman and Ar-Rahim. Ar-Rahman is a beautiful name for Allah. And the attribute or the quality that can be found in this name is Rahmah, which is merciful. So we believe that Allah is merciful. But in order for us to understand the names and attributes of Allah, there are three important points that we need to understand when it comes to the beautiful names and the most perfect attributes of Allah. So Allah has beautiful names. Allah says in the Quran, وَلِلَّهِ الْأَسْمَاءُ الْحُسْنَى فَادْعُوهُ بِهَا. In Surah Al-A'raf, Allah mentions and He says that for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are the beautiful names, so call upon them. So Allah has beautiful names and Allah has the most perfect attributes. So what is our position when it comes to the beautiful names and the most perfect attributes? First of all, Ahlus Sunnati wal Jama'ah. They say that we affirm for Allah whatever He has affirmed for Himself in His noble book. Or we negate for Allah whatever He has negated for Himself in His noble book. Or that which has been affirmed by the Messenger of Allah in His Sunnah, or that which has been negated by the Messenger of Allah in the Sunnah. With its wording and meaning, lafzan wa ma'na. So for example, Allah affirms in the Quran that He is Rahman. So we believe that His beautiful name is Rahman, and we believe that He has the quality of being merciful. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Quran that He is Al-Alim, that He is the most knowledgeable. So we affirm the name Al-Alim, and we affirm the quality or the attribute of knowledge, that Allah has knowledge. And like this, all the attributes in the Quran. The second point is that we do not make any resemblance to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nothing can be compared, and there is no resemblance between Him and the creation. So the human being is merciful, but is the mercy of the human being like the mercy of Allah? The human being is knowledgeable, but is the knowledge of the human being like the knowledge of Allah? No. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Quran that He created Adam alayhi salam with His two hands. مَا مَنَعَكَ أَن تَسْجُدَ بِمَا خَلَقْتُ بِيَدَيْهِ. So we affirm that Allah has two hands, as He mentioned Himself in the Quran, but His hands are not like the hands of a human being. Anybody that makes any resemblance to Allah with any of His attributes, then this is kufr, blasphemy, and he has left the fold of Islam. And this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Ash-Shura, ayah number 11. لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ وَهُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْبَصِيرُ. There is nothing like Him. He is the all-hearing, the all-seeing. Now let me ask you this question. Do we hear? And does Allah hear? Na'am, we hear. But the hearing of Allah is not like the hearing of a human being. Do we see? We have eyes, we can see. But the seeing of Allah is not like the seeing of a human being. And this is the second point. And the third and the last point is that these attributes of Allah, the reality, the haqiqah, or the kayfiyah, or the howness, is only known to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Just like Allah said that He's Ar-Rahman and He's merciful, we don't know the reality of His mercy. We cannot comprehend His mercy. We cannot comprehend any of His attributes. If He says that He can see, He can hear, He has knowledge, He is merciful, He has two hands, affirm that which Allah has affirmed for himself without asking why and how and wanting to know the realities. And we will end this khutbah with a small story of Imam Malik rahimahullah ta'ala. Imam Malik rahimahullah ta'ala was teaching in the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's masjid. As you know, al-Masjid al-Nabawi, the Prophet's masjid in Medina. And he would teach near the grave of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which is when you enter through Babu Salam, the old masjid of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which was 50 meters by 50 meters. This was the hudud of the masjid of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When he was teaching, somebody came and asked him a question. He says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Quran, Ar-Rahmanu ala al-Arsh istawa, that the Rahman, he rose above the throne. Allah is above the throne. We as Ahl Sunnati wal Jama'ah believe that Allah is above the throne. Allah's knowledge is in every place. Wa ilmuhu fi kulli makan, as Imam Malik says. But Allah himself is above the throne. So this man, he came and he asked Imam Malik, he said, how is Allah above the throne? So Imam Malik rahimahullah was teaching. He stopped teaching. And the complex of his face changed. Became perplexed. And then he stopped for a while. And then he looked down and then he raised his head. He said, where is the questioner who asked this question? That how did Allah ascend above the throne? They said, this is the question. And he said something which deserves to be written in gold ink. He said, "At-ta'rifu ma'rufun, wa kayfiyyatu majhulun, wal imanu bihi wajibun, was su'alu anhu al bid'ah." You got that? Allah informed us that he rose above the throne, he ascended above the throne. This is known in the Arabic language. Istiwa is known, and we affirm this. How he rose above the throne is beyond human understanding. وَالْإِيمَانُ بِهِ وَاجِبٌ. If Allah mentioned that he rose above the throne, he ascended above the throne, to believe in this is wajib, because it's mentioned in the Quran. وَالسُّؤَالُ عَنْهُ الْبِدْعَةِ. And to ask such questions is a bid'ah in the deen. Don't ask such questions. This is understood. So this is with regards to the beautiful names and the most perfect attributes. So today we have learned that At-Tawheed has three principles. Singling out Allah in his actions. Singling out Allah when it comes to our actions legislated by Allah. And believing in the beautiful names and attributes of Allah without resembling them to the creation. And without asking how. If a person believes in this, then he has established the Tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us the tawfiq to learn about the Tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I say that every single Muslim organization, every single masjid, should not stop or cease from having lessons weekly on the issue of Tawheed. Every single masjid should teach the communities over and over again. Tawheed is a process which should never be ceased in any masjid or in any organization. Tawheed must be the pinnacle of your da'wah. If there is no Tawheed, there is no da'wah. As I mentioned in the beginning of my khutbah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us death upon this tawheed, give us the tawfiq to learn about this tawheed and know that the reason where Muslims are being oppressed in the dunya, anywhere in the world, whether it's Palestine or whether it's India or whether it's Nepal, wherever it may be, is because of their tawheed. The tawheed is the real issue. Because they have tawheed, if they give up their tawheed, they will be left alone. The issue and the qadiyah is about the tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So know this issue, that the most precious thing that you have is your tawheed. If you have your tawheed and you have shortcomings, Allah will enter you into Jannah. Because why? You did not neglect the rights and violate the rights of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillah.